Praise God. Praise God. That was Holy Ghost, Chinley. Thank God. Let's give them a big hand again. I really appreciate that. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's beyond words, the impact this conference has been on me personally, and I believe there's lots of people that would say the same. What an amazing thing we're a part of. Can you say amen? And it always gets better just because we start planting churches. So we're going to believe God tonight. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. Believe God for help on World Evangelism Night. Classic story from all the way back in 1990, what was called the Gulf War or Desert Storm. But to set this up for some of the younger folk, I want you to imagine a world with no email. No digital cameras, no smartphones, no texting or internet or social media. And these soldiers are stationed halfway around the world, and the story was about a U.S. soldier who was there. And while he was there, he received a letter from his girlfriend in the United States. And she unceremoniously informed him or dumped him, informing him that she's breaking up with him, and she was not very nice about it. And according to the story, to add insult to injury, she ended the letter by telling him to send back the photo she had given him. So when his soldier friends heard of this, they all got together to help him with a reply. So what they did was they got a shoebox, and all these soldiers donated the photos of their girlfriends till they filled the shoebox totally full. They then crafted a letter from the soldier to this girl, and it went something like this: "Dear so-and-so, I got your letter breaking up with me, and I want to honor your request by returning your picture. But for the life of me, I can't remember what you look like. So I've sent you a box full of pictures of my other girlfriends. Please find yours, remove it, and send the rest back to me." You gotta be part of something bigger than yourself to pull that off. And that's true. That's no more true than World Evangelism Night. That we are a part of something so much bigger than ourselves. And I thank God for that. I want to minister from Matthew 6, one verse of scripture I'm going to read, and then we'll refer to some of the others. A sermon I've called The Kingdom Economy. The Kingdom Economy. We're going to read verse 33, Jesus said, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you." I want to look first of all at the kingdom principle. The modern church has mistakenly put the emphasis of the gospel on the wrong place. And I'm sure we know this, but I want to point out one particular error that is very egregious here, and that is, for many in the modern church, the gospel to them is primarily about sins forgiven and salvation. And while that is definitely important, and we understand that's fundamental, the reality, the gospel message is primarily about the kingdom of God. And that's why both John the Baptist and Jesus Christ himself, when they came and began their ministry, preached the same sermon. And it was a very simple sermon, and that was, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here. Salvation and the offer of salvation and forgiveness, which is fundamental to the gospel, is tethered to the reality of submitting to God's kingdom. Because what defines us as sinners is really beyond the, you know, the multiple choice list of violations that you can commit. But the very definition of a sinner is someone that's in rebellion to God and to his rule in their lives. There's a book I read in the beginning of my ministry that I'm going to be quoting from. And this author's name is Jack Taylor. He said, "The gospel is the gospel of the kingdom, not merely salvation. To dilute the message of the gospel of Jesus to a mere plan of salvation dishonors the kingdom and does a huge disservice to the church. Undoubtedly, the cross holds an undeniable place of prominence in the gospel narrative, but Jesus came preaching a kingdom, not just salvation. His first and foremost focus was on citizenship, not rescue." What does this look like in the modern church? It looks like promoting forgiveness without any other obligation. And this is the downfall. This is the slander. This is the diluting of this powerful gospel that is somehow a full pardon from all sin is offered by simply praying a one-off prayer without any repentance or without any follow-up obedience. And the problem with mankind involves sin, without a doubt, but it's much greater because that sin, as I said, is a rejection of God's lordship and the resulting loss of dominion of God in every area of our lives. What happens when a human being is in rebellion to God and not submitting to the lordship of Jesus Christ is Lucifer invades and oppresses every part of a person's life. Verse 33 is the kingdom principle, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Again, Jack Taylor, once we put the kingdom in its rightful place of preeminence in our personal lives, we discovered that everything else we need is ours in it. This is not to be confused with the kingdom now theology, which is false doctrine, that teaches that somehow the church must first establish God's rule on earth for him to return. The truth is, as born-again Christians, spirit-filled believers, when we put God's kingdom first in our lives, the fruit of that is dominion, and Pastor Campbell preached this powerfully. That is our portion, and that is what God intends for people to have, is a dominion in life. God designed Adam and Eve to rule, and while ruling, they enjoyed this relationship with the Creator. It was this relationship that allowed them to rule. And when they sinned, they forfeited both their relationship and dominion. And Jesus came to restore both. Again, I quote, "The Son represented the desire of the Father to restore all creation to its original order. The kingdom of heaven is that order. We are commanded to pursue the kingdom first." What that means is we are forgiven, thank God. We are born again, filled with the Holy Ghost. But the fruit of that is to experience the power of God's kingdom on this side of eternity. That means healing, amen. That means deliverance. That means breaking the curse. It means God's blessing and power at work in our lives. Jesus said, "If I cast out devils, you know the kingdom of God has come to you. These signs shall follow them that believe. Heal the sick, cast out devils, speak in tongues." This is what God has been doing in this conference. Can you say amen? There's been an overwhelming, awesome sense of his power that is available. The kingdom of God is to encompass every area of life. Somebody said, we need not wait for the sweet by and by. We need the rule of God with all his power for the nasty here and now. That's not a guarantee that life will be without trials, This is not a promise that there will be no reversals or challenges. It means we have promises to overcome. As one man said, when the kingdom of God is declared, no other power can oppose it. So I want to look secondly then at the kingdom priority. Many religions, even churches, embrace extreme views of what spirituality is meant to look like. And this is true, especially as it applies to money. One of the extremes that is very wrong and very harmful is the false notion that spirituality and faith promise limitless wealth and abundance. We would call this the prosperity gospel, or what we would see in many of the televangelists through history and even many of the churches that pass themselves off as gospel. And that is that somehow faith, somehow spirituality, somehow this is going to compute into wealth, and this is going to compute into an abundance and limitless abundance. And Jesus, in this very chapter, he says so many things about treasure and wealth and these things that bring such a clear balance. Verse 24, he says very clearly that there's a warning here, that if you turn the promises of God into a love for wealth, it can become an idol. And this can become off, and this can become very perverse and seductive. This is the point Richard Ruby was making in his offering, and that is that, you know, thank God for the promises of Scripture, but our giving and our sacrifice is an obligation. The Bible says it is our reasonable service, the only reasonable, rational thing to do in response to what Christ has already done for us is to lay our lives down as a living sacrifice. It is right that we sacrifice. And the truth is, many saints receive their reward on the other side of eternity. And that is a very, very true and balanced part. So the extreme, that the idea that the gospel is a guaranteed ticket to wealth and abundance is an extreme. On the other extreme, it's just as false a notion, is the idea that any accumulation of wealth is both unspiritual and sinful. We could call this the Mother Teresa attitude. That if you're going to serve God, you must be dirt poor. If you're really spiritual, then you're going to have to just, you know, move up into the mountains and live in a tent and eat bugs. Because anything other than that is carnal, it's worldly. And I heard about and read about a time in her ministry when she actually had a building donated to her and to the ministry that she was leading, but it bothered her that it had plumbing, and it actually had hot water and carpets, and she had them all ripped out because that was going to do what? It was going to mess with the vibe. It's not poor enough. That's ridiculous. We know of religious groups, the Amish and the Quakers and some that are related to that, that they, in their desire to avoid worldliness, they arbitrarily denounce modern conveniences and technology as if somehow this is a sign of true spirituality. And this can result in an unbalanced view of Scripture, even verses in this chapter, Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 and 20, is a much misunderstood verse of Scripture. Jesus said, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal." And so at first glance, to a Westerner and to an English translation, that looks like a prohibition on any accumulation of wealth. And if you study that out, it's not that. It wouldn't make sense if it was. It's literally a Hebrew figure of speech. It's often used in the New Testament. And as you look at the examples of this figure of speech using, you find it's not forbidding what's mentioned first. It's a warning to not make that the priority. An example would be working a job for men for physical food versus working for spiritual things. John 6:27, Jesus says, "Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you." How many of you have had new converts that said, "Pastor, there it is. I'm quitting my job. I'm going to witness all day." It says right here that I shouldn't work for the food that perishes. But that's not what it's saying. What he's saying is don't let secular work be the main or principal thing in your life, but rather make working for God be the main or principal thing in your life. A more accurate reading of that would be, do not labor primarily for the food which perishes, but rather put priority on laboring for the food which endures to everlasting life. And the minute you see that, it begins to make sense. So Matthew 6:19-20 would better read, do not put priority on laying up for yourselves treasures on earth, but put your priority on laying up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Because understanding this causes the text to make perfect sense. Because in verse 33 again, he says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. That word added means to give more or to increase or proceed further, to place additionally or lay beside. You can call this the accumulation assumption. People have called it redemption and lift. There's a danger in it because of the love of money, because of what can happen. But the trigger that Jesus is putting to this is a decision to give the kingdom of God priority. Because this isn't about just being forgiven. This is about a kingdom. This isn't just about going to heaven. This is about a kingdom. And a kingdom involves a king. And a kingdom involves others. And the kingdom involves a commission. And the kingdom involves an obligation that we have to the big picture. And it looks like a couple of things. In beginning, it looks like not only putting God first in our tithes and our offerings, but it means putting the kingdom and God's will for our lives before everything. Who we are to minister to, what we are to do, where we are to live, what our ministry is, what our participation is in the body of Christ, in the local church, comes before family. It comes before career. It comes before personal preference. Because it's a kingdom. We repent of our rebellious, self-willed lifestyle, for the kingdom of God is here. And when we put the king and the kingdom in the right place, Jesus said, you don't have to worry. You don't have to worry about what you're going to eat. You don't have to worry about what you're going to wear. You don't have to worry about reaping and gathering. Verse 32, your Father knows you need these things. God does not begrudge these things. He says he knows there's a need, but seek first the kingdom of God, and all of these will be added to you. The question is, when it comes to making deposits of our time, our potential, our abilities, our money, what gets top billing? What gets priority? Earth and the earthly, or the kingdom? Because you're not taking it with you. But you can send it on ahead. What did somebody say? I've never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul. Like the poor old guy that died, left a will. And in his will, he instructed that $30,000 be spent on his funeral. He had only one distant relative, was a woman that hardly knew him. And so she, she organizes the funeral, and as the funeral was ending and the last of the visitors were leaving, his only relative that hardly knew him turned to her friend that came along and said, "Well, I think he would be pleased." And the friend leaned in close and said, "Come on, how much did this really cost? I mean, come on, it was nice, but $30,000? And the relative said, oh yes, the funeral was $6,500. I donated $1,000 to the church, and the food and drinks were another $500. The rest went for the memorial stone." Friend said, $22,000 for a memorial stone? My goodness, how big was it? The relative flashed her hand with her new diamond ring. Said, "This memorial stone is about 2.5 carats. Jesus said, when the believer, by faith, lives giving the kingdom of God priority, the power of God's kingdom takes over. And the promise is that everything needed will be added to us. So I want to close then with the kingdom privilege, thirdly. These quotes that I'm giving you from a man named Jack Taylor is from a book that back when I began my ministry was given or recommended to me, and it was called God's Miraculous Plan of Economy. He since rewrote it. It's called True Wealth. And made a huge impact in my view of money. In the beginning of the book, he says these words, "In my judgment, the greatest thing I can do for a man is to tell him how to be saved. The second greatest thing I can do for him is to tell him how to be filled and walk in the Spirit. The third is how to be rightly related to God with his money." It goes on to talk about what we believe, and that is the Bible term for the kingdom economy is stewardship. Stewardship basically is very simple. It means God owns everything. God owns everything. Say that. God owns everything. You either believe that or you don't. Seriously, that's going to separate the people in this room, the people who fundamentally believe that and live by that, and those who can't quite bring themselves to live according to that truth. God owns everything. We are managing his wealth for him. And as we show ourselves capable and faithful, that's pleasing to him. And there's going to be an accounting. We are going to be held accountable for everything that has been laid into our hands, every opportunity, every skill, the power to get wealth, what we were called to do, who we were called to do it with, what was placed in our hands to do it with, what was entrusted to us at whatever role that we played in the local church. And he's going to hold us accountable. And when he sees faithfulness, the Bible says he is confident to entrust us with more. Old Testament examples, obviously Joseph went from prisoner to prime minister. And aside from God's big plan that he understood from the beginning on paper, he was promoted in every stage of his story because he was trustworthy. He qualified. And when he became the prime minister, he was steward over all of Pharaoh's wealth. You know, that's a good gig. That's not a bad gig, man. You know, if you wake up one day and you're like manager of a huge bank, that's not a bad job. You know, that's going to affect, you know, where you live and what you drive. I'm sure Joseph's chariots had spinners and who knows? I don't know. He probably had a nice wardrobe, but the bottom line is it wasn't his. It never was his. It belonged to somebody else. And there's obviously perks to being the steward over Potiphar's house or Pharaoh's kingdom. And while Joseph was doing this, Pharaoh was very happy for Joseph to be blessed. You and I have the opportunity to be stewards for the King of the universe. I mean, think about that. The tithe is the beginning of stewardship. It's just a symbol of us embracing the reality that everything belongs to him. It's just us telling him every time that we get increases, you know what? I haven't forgot that you own this. It's a celebration. It's like, wow, check it out, God. Look what you did for me. It's not generosity. You're not giving anything away. You don't give your tithe. You pay your tithe. Try going to the bank, you know, if you had $1,000 in the bank, and try going in and withdrawing $100 and watch if the teller starts doing the backslider shuffle on you, you know, like, you know, a little tight this week, and we had, you know, the brakes on the car went out, and had some visitors. You'd lean in like, you're not telling me you're not going to give me my money, are you? And when they do, you're not like, whoa, you're awesome. That was amazing. You just handed me a Benjamin. I mean, you might be polite and say thank you, but there's no generosity there. It's like, you got a job because I put my money in the bank here. I'm not even going to go into banks charging you to make deposits. I'm not even going to go there. It's a violation. Like, I'm doing you a favor, man. You're not paying me any interest. You're loaning it to stupid people for 12% interest. You have a job because I gave you my money. It's like you didn't do me any favors. Can you say amen? You pay your tithe. That's the beginning. The truth is, God can ask for the rest anytime he wants. So can you. It's up to him. It's just a different test. The tithe is one type of test. The offering is a different type of test. Because God can speak to you. Or it can be a free will offering, which also tests you. It's a test. What do you value? If I was to give you this much money, and my only instructions were, I want you to take care of my bride until I come marry her. Just look after my bride, would you? And then all of a sudden the bride has a need, he might step in and go, I want to watch what you do about this, because she's pretty important to me. You know, the church is going to have a need in a few minutes. You're going to stand some people up here. And there's going to be some need generated. And sometimes God will speak to you, but sometimes he just says, I want to see what you're going to do. I want to see what you care about. I want to see how badly you're going to look after my bride or the mother church. It's a different test, but it's all stewardship. And good stewards build their lives consistent with this reality. God, in turn, promises to bless with more. Luke 16:10. Whoever can be trusted with a little can also be trusted with a lot. And whoever is dishonest with a little is dishonest with a lot. If you cannot be trusted with worldly riches, who can trust you with your true riches? If you cannot be trusted with things that belong to someone else, who will give you things of your own? The result of stewardship is, I believe, God's intention is that it breaks the corrupting power that money has on the sin nature. When we live as stewards, and we, you know, God is not begrudging, you know, God doesn't give it to you because he wants to take it all away. Can you say amen? He doesn't give it to you so you feel guilty. He just wants you to steward it. And I believe it's this genius system that breaks the corrupting power of money. Because our sin nature can get twisted right here. When we went to Kenya and God began to do a miracle, we were able to pay for the conference, which was a miracle. And then we were able to begin to send offerings to Prescott on World Evangelism Night. And leaders began to rise up and churches began to flourish and people were getting jobs and people's salaries were beginning to increase. And it was amazing. And I remember then coming back to the U.S. and in the middle of conference, I got a call from the pastor in Nairobi and said, "Pastor, I have a problem." I said, "What's that?" He said, "Somebody put 17 100 US dollar bills in the offering plate." Well, I said, "That's not a problem, bro." But he had no idea what to do with that. That is a lot of money in Kenya. The next conference, he called me again. He says, "I have another problem. Somebody put 36 100 dollar bills." Now listen, the American is gone. There weren't any, you know, obvious candidates out there that, like, oh, maybe it was that person. Like, who in the world is putting that kind of money? Listen, that would be like somebody throwing $75,000 to $150,000 in your offering plate. Hallelujah, indeed. And that happened every 6 months for a period of time, and we're still not sure who did that. Verse 21, and people get this wrong a lot of times. So where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Many get this backwards. They say, if you love God, you're going to give because your treasure follows your heart. But that's not what he's saying. He's saying where your treasure is, your heart will follow. When you, by an act of your will, decide to do right by God, to structure your life, putting the kingdom first, live within your means, live below your means, knowing that God is generous, that in time God can help you. You leave room for the tithe, you leave room to participate, you begin to live your life this way, you make decisions about your job based on how it's going to affect your ministry. You make decisions about where you're going to live based on where God wants you to live. And you seek first the kingdom of God, and then you begin to invest. That doesn't mean you shouldn't look after your future, you shouldn't buy a house, or shouldn't have a savings account. He's just saying that you need to budget for the kingdom of God. The man with the build bigger barns, his sin was he was not rich toward God. In his abundance, he was not rich toward God. And if you begin to make this a part of your focus and your rejoicing, where your treasure is, your heart will follow. In other words, your heart is going to follow what you invest, the primary energies and values of your life. You want to stay on track with God? I don't know about you, but the longer I serve God, the more that becomes a factor. I pray, God, I want to finish well. You want to stay on track? Make sure your heart stays connected to the eternal by laying up treasures in heaven. And in turn, God will be able to trust you with blessing without fear of backsliding. I close with an old story about a sailor shipwrecked on one of the South Sea Islands. He was seized by the natives, hoisted to their shoulders, carried to the village, and set on a rude throne. Little by little, he learned this was their custom, once each year to make a man a king for a year. He liked it until he began to wonder what happened to all the former kings. Soon he discovered that every year when his kingship had ended, the king was banished to a certain nearby island where he starved to death. The sailor did not like that, but he was smart, and he was king. King for a year. So he put his carpenters to work making boats. He put his farmers to work transplanting fruit trees to the island. Workers to plow the field and fertilize. Masons to build a house. So when his kingship was over, he was banished. Not to a barren island, but an island of abundance. Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where the thieves cannot steal. It's the kingdom economy. I'd like every head bowed and every eye closed.